Hello, this is Dr. Grande. Today's question asks if I can analyze the Yolanda Salvidar murder case. Salvidar was convicted in 1995 of killing Selena Quintanilla. Just a reminder, I'm not diagnosing anybody in this video, only speculating about what could be happening in a situation like this. If you enjoy this video, please like it, subscribe to my channel, and consider supporting me on Patreon. I'll put the link to Patreon in the description for this video. So first I'll look at the background of Yolanda Salvidar, and then I'll move to my analysis. Yolanda Salvidar was born in San Antonio, Texas on September 19, 1960. In 1991, Yolanda attended a concert featuring a rising musical star named Selena Quintanilla, and immediately took an interest in her. Selena was 11 years younger than Yolanda. Yolanda contacted Selena's father, Abraham Quintanilla, who was also Selena's manager, and asked if she could start a fan club in San Antonio. After repeated requests, about 15 by Abraham's count, he finally gave in. Yolanda left her job as a nurse to become president of the fan club, taking a pay cut in the process. Initially, her job was to manage membership benefits. Each member would send in $22 and receive certain items, like a t-shirt. Eventually, the fan club grew to about 5,000 members. Over time, Yolanda and Selena became closer, with Yolanda taking on more responsibility. In 1994, Selena opened a boutique in Corpus Christi and another one in San Antonio. Abraham selected Yolanda to run the boutiques, even though he would later say he always mistrusted her. Perhaps he had a literal interpretation of the phrase, keep your friends close and your enemies closer. This promotion only granted Yolanda more power over Selena's finances, including access to an American Express card paid for by Selena. The card was supposed to be used for company business, but Yolanda had something else in mind. She used the card to go to expensive restaurants, purchase 2 cell phones, which back then were particularly expensive, and she would rent Lincoln Town Cars, because when you're committing fraud, it is important to do it in style. Yolanda was not an effective manager in other ways as well. The employees did not like her, referring to her as unstable and two-faced. Yolanda would routinely fire employees who she didn't like. There was a lot of division, but Selena would not take action. She trusted Yolanda and became increasingly dependent on her. Yolanda even had the keys to Selena's house. Yolanda would claim that Selena referred to her as mom and that Selena would regularly send her tokens of affection. Yolanda seemed to be obsessed with Selena. She would play videos of Selena for her friends. She had pictures and posters of Selena in her residence and told employees she wanted to be like Selena. Yolanda started restricting access to Selena, trying to control her, attempting to disrupt relationships Selena had with other people. In September 1994, Selena started a relationship with a man named Ricardo Martinez. He was a business advisor, and there have been some allegations of an affair. Yolanda was not pleased with how close those two were. In January 1995, calls were coming in from members of the fan club who were upset because they sent in money, but they didn't receive any products. In addition, employees at the boutiques noticed that many of the bills were overdue. Abraham looked into these matters and found that Yolanda had been forging checks. She had stolen over $60,000. Abraham confronted her in March of 1995, but she just stared at him and didn't say anything. Yolanda was relieved of her responsibilities, although not technically fired, and was told not to have contact with Selena. Yolanda went to a gun shop in San Antonio and bought a Taurus Model 85. This is a 5-shot, 38 caliber revolver. She also purchased hollow point ammunition. Selena and Yolanda met on March 14, 1995. Selena told Yolanda that she could continue managing her business affairs. Yolanda showed Selena the revolver, and Selena told her to get rid of the firearm, pledging to protect her from the people that Yolanda thought were out to get her. Yolanda went back to the gun shop the next day and told the clerk her father had given her a .22 caliber pistol and she didn't need the Taurus anymore. They took the gun back and gave her a refund. Then we see that Selena told Yolanda that she needed to return some of the missing bank statements. On March 27, Yolanda returned to the gun shop and repurchased the Taurus. She asked Selena to meet her in a hotel room, but when Selena arrived, her fans were everywhere. One theory is that Yolanda intended to kill Selena that day. On March 30, Yolanda checks into a Days Inn motel in Corpus Christi. She calls Selena and asks for a meeting at the motel. Yolanda claimed that she had been sexually assaulted in Mexico. Selena and her husband went to the motel. Her husband waited in the vehicle. Selena met with Yolanda, and Yolanda gave her several documents. But on the ride home, Selena realized that Yolanda did not give her the correct documents. Selena would return to the Days Inn the next day, March 31, 1995. This time, she was alone. She drove Yolanda to the hospital so that Yolanda could be checked out because of that alleged attack in Mexico. The physician said that Yolanda was depressed, but they weren't really sure about her claims about being assaulted. The pair went back to the motel room. They started arguing so loudly that the guests complained about the noise. Selena demanded the financial documents from Yolanda. At about 15 minutes to noon, Yolanda pointed the revolver at Selena. Selena turned and ran toward the door, and Yolanda shot her once in the lower right shoulder. The bullet exited through her chest. Selena was mortally wounded, but not immediately killed. As she ran out the door, Yolanda called her a derogatory name. Selena ran 130 yards to the motel lobby, screaming that she had been shot. She would collapse on the floor of the lobby at about 10 minutes to noon. Selena identified Yolanda Salvidar as the person who shot her. She also indicated what room she was in, room 158. Selena was pronounced dead at 1:05 p.m. after being taken to the hospital. After the shooting, Yolanda climbed into her pickup truck and tried to escape, but a police officer confronted her. She parked the truck in a parking space, only to be blocked in moments later by the police. She pointed the revolver at her right temple and threatened to bring an end to her life. This led to a standoff during which Yolanda claimed that the shooting was accidental, only after a negotiator brought up that idea. Yolanda would surrender after about 9 hours. She was charged with murder and tried in Houston, Texas, not Corpus Christi. There was a change in venue as there were concerns about whether Yolanda could receive a fair trial in an area with so many of Selena's fans. In October 1995, Yolanda Salvidar was found guilty of murder in the first degree and sentenced to life in prison with the possibility of parole after 30 years. Now moving to the mental health and personality factors. Other than the brief assessment in the hospital where the staff said that Yolanda may have been depressed, we don't really have any information about Yolanda's mental health. Since Yolanda was sentenced to prison, she has come up with fanciful stories about what happened. She has repeatedly appealed to get a new trial. We see one particular interview that really exemplifies the nonsensical, narcissistic, and evasive nature of her narrative. She was talking about the day of the homicide, which she called an accident. Yolanda claimed that in the motel room, Selena never fired her. Selena was begging at her feet for Yolanda to come back and work for her. While this was happening, Yolanda had the revolver pointed at her own head. She said she pulled back the thingy on the gun. I assume she means the hammer. She told Selena that if she didn't leave, she would pull the trigger. Selena went to close the door. Yolanda motioned with the gun and said, "Don't close that door." And in that instant, the gun magically discharged. So we're supposed to believe that Selena was begging Yolanda to work for her. Yolanda was the one rejecting Selena. She was the one telling her to leave the motel room after asking her to come see her that day. This is the story that Yolanda was going with. Later, we see that Yolanda comes up with another story, this time about a mystery man who was threatening Selena. Yolanda claimed to have tapes and a diary that supported this theory. She even sent her attorney at the time to retrieve all this evidence, but when he went to the various locations that Yolanda indicated, nothing was there. It seems fairly clear that Yolanda planned to kill Selena and probably would have killed her on an earlier date, but Yolanda kept holding out hope that Selena would restore her to power. So going back through the thought processes that led to this homicide, here's what may have happened. Yolanda was socially awkward and isolated. She didn't really have many friends. Her narcissism, manipulative tendencies, and antagonism had driven people away. She sees in Selena what she wished she could be. Selena was the embodiment of Yolanda's narcissistic fantasy. Yolanda works hard to get close to Selena. She was determined, again repeatedly, contacting Selena's father. She wanted to manipulate Selena and use Selena's fame and success to make her powerful as well. This whole time, Yolanda feels entitled. She sees all this money coming in from the fan club and eventually from the boutiques and thinks to herself, she should just take it. She deserves it. She fails to see the distinction between money that belongs to Selena and money that belongs to her. In her mind, she has become one with Selena. Yolanda's relationship with Selena satisfies Yolanda's narcissistic drive. It confirms that she's really a good and valuable person. People really love her, respect her, and look up to her. It gives her an opportunity to dominate and control Selena's other employees, pouring even more fuel onto the fire of narcissism. So all of the adoration and attention that was directed towards Selena was being captured by Yolanda. She was living vicariously through Selena. When Yolanda's criminal activity comes to light, the relationship with Selena is threatened. Yolanda cannot stand the idea of being separated from Selena. Losing Selena means going back to being ordinary, a status that a narcissist cannot tolerate. This was more than losing a job. This was a threat to Yolanda's identity. Rather than face her own failure, she seeks to destroy Selena, to make Selena pay for the rejection. She contemplates killing her several times, but is restrained by the hope of being restored to the position of glory. When it becomes clear that this will never happen, she points the gun at Selena, Selena turns to escape, and Yolanda pulls the trigger. Even though it was premeditated, Yolanda did not have a real plan for escape. She probably intended on bringing an end to her life after killing Selena. But the same narcissism that led her to killing Selena protected Yolanda from herself. This case really illustrates the dangers of narcissism. Yolanda Saldivar had no criminal history, no indication of antisocial behavior other than stealing money, and yet she would go on to commit first-degree murder. The problem with narcissism in a case like this is that the fantasy extends so far beyond reality that when that fantasy crashes, as it must at some point, the difference between the narcissistic fantasy and reality is too much for the person to handle. The narcissist simply cannot accept the truth, so they look to force the situation with violence. To them, revenge is a more acceptable substitute for the protective factor of narcissism, for the high of narcissism, than something like failure or taking ownership. Yolanda Saldivar has become one of the most hated people in history. From her point of view, this is probably better than a life of obscurity. What lesson can we learn from this case? Do not reward a narcissist. People who feel entitled to power are the last people who should obtain it. Those are my thoughts on the Selena Quintanilla case. Please put any opinions and thoughts in the comment section. They always generate an interesting dialogue. As always, I hope you found my analysis of this topic to be elucidating. Thanks for watching.